Hi, in our previous videos, we have talked about different measures for coefficient of skewness like Karl Pearson's moment coefficient of skewness, Kelly's coefficient of skewness and so on. Today we'll talk about Bowley's coefficient of skewness, which is another important coefficient or measure for skewness. So first of all, let's understand what's the difference between Karl Pearson's coefficient of skewness and Bowley's coefficient of skewness. When we were talking about Karl Pearson's coefficient of skewness, we were talking about mode, median and mean. But in Bowley's coefficient of skewness, we will be mainly talking about quartiles. We have already discussed about quartiles in details in our previous, some of our previous videos. So today, basically, we will be talking about Bowley's coefficient of skewness, which revolves completely around quartiles. So let's understand. First of all, let's understand what are quartiles. We all know that for quartiles, basically quartiles divide our entire distribution into four equal parts. That is Q1, Q2, Q3. Here Q1 contains 25% of the data, right? From beginning to Q1, then Q1 to Q2 contains 25% of the data. Then this contains again 25% and 25% each. So basically, our entire data is divided into four equal parts based on the observation. That is, 25% of the observations will be in this range, 25% over here, 25% over here, and 25% over here. Right? So now, let's talk about symmetric distribution first. When I'm talking about symmetric distribution, we all know we are simply saying something like this. And as we have discussed in Karl Pearson's coefficient of skewness as well, for a symmetric distribution, our mean is equal to mode, which is equal to median, right? But from Bowley's point of view, we can say that this is our Q1 and this is our Q3, right? And over here, since we know that median is always our second quartile, that is Q2, because it contains 50% of the data towards the left and 50% data towards the right, right? So since the data is symmetric, we all know that basically in symmetric distributions, the number, the gapping, the difference between basically you can say mean and each observation is symmetric towards left and right both sides. And similar goes for mode and median as well. So we can say that in this case, Q2 minus Q1, that is this gap, and Q3 minus Q2, that is this gap, must be equal. Therefore, we can say that for a symmetric distribution, our Q3 minus Q2, this gap is equal to Q2 minus Q1. This difference is equal to this difference. Now let's see what is the case of negative and positive skewness. So now we all know that if our data is positively skewed, or we can simply write this out as skewness. So positive skewness. So in this case, our graph looks somewhat like this. Because in positively skewed, our data is more skewed towards the positive side. A positive side means that basically we have outliers towards the larger values. Right? Now in this case, we know here is our mode. And in positive skewness, from Karl Pearson's coefficient of skewness and from the symmetric data that we've already seen in our previous videos, we always have our median over here. Towards the right of mode, or we can also say it as Q2. Now, our Q1 is always towards the left. So here's our Q1. And Q3 is towards the right of Q2. So this is our Q3. But now, since we know that most of the values are outliers towards the right of Q2, and these values are basically larger than the other observations, so we can say the gap between Q3 and Q2, this difference, Q3 minus Q2, will always be greater than this difference, that is Q2 minus Q1. Why? Because this Q3 will be quite large since these values are outliers. But over here, since these values are not outliers, these are more of the values that are concentrated. So we can say that this gap will be less than this gap. So we can simply say that for positive skewness, our Q3 minus Q2 is always greater than Q2 minus Q1. Right? On the other hand, now let's talk about negative skewness or negatively skewed data. So in this case, we know our negatively skewed data somewhat looks like this. Right? So in this case, this is our mode. And always median lies towards the left of mode. This is median, or you can also call it as Q2. So obviously our Q3 will lie somewhere over here. And Q1 somewhere over here. These are more towards the outliers. So again, using the similar thing, again we know that in negative skewness, this sign changes completely. That is, in terms of negative skewness, always Q3 minus Q2 is less than Q2 minus Q1. Why? Because since these are outliers, this Q1 will be quite a smaller amount, quite a smaller value as compared to Q2. But, and since this data is negatively skewed, Q2 will be somewhere near to Q3. So the distance, so difference between Q3 and Q2 will always be less than Q2 and Q1. Right? So this is the basic difference between this, and so this tells us the skewness, whether our data is negatively skewed or it is positively skewed. But now we can see one thing. When I'm saying Q3 minus Q2, this Q3 have its units along, just like median. Centimeters, meters, kgs, liters, kiloliters, etc. Right? So when we'll take its difference, it will again be a number with the units with it. But we have already seen in our other measures also, that generally if we want to compare skewness of two different distributions, and we have the unit terms along with it, like centimeters, kgs, we cannot compare them, right? So for that, we need a relative measure. And so first of all, we can simply say that skewness is equal to Q3 minus Q2, right? This difference minus Q2 minus Q1, this difference. We can see from here, right? And if this is greater than 0, then it's a positive skewness. If it's less than 0, negative skewness. If it is equal to 0, then it's symmetric data. Right? But again, we know this has some units along. Let's suppose Q3 is 20 centimeter. Q2 is 10 centimeter. And Q1 is 5 centimeter. Now, putting in the values over here, we get 20 minus 10 minus Q2 minus Q1 is 10 minus 5. So this is simply equal to 10 minus 5. That is 5. But we already have the centimeters over here. This also becomes 5 centimeters. Right? So we cannot compare if we have two distributions, one in kgs and one in centimeters. So avoid these problems. We have a relative measure that is known as Bowley's Coefficient of skewness. This is simply equal to Q3 minus Q2 minus Q2 minus Q1 upon Q3 minus Q2 plus Q2 minus Q1. So this we can say is simply equal to Q3 plus Q1 minus 2Q2 upon Q3 Q3 minus Q1. Since we know this is our median, we can also write it as Q3 plus Q1 minus 2 median upon Q3 minus Q1. Right? So this is our formula for Bowley's coefficient of skewness. Since this is also a difference and this is also a difference and addition, so both the terms will be in centimeters. We will cancel it out and we'll get a perfect measure. Right? So we need to, let's note down a few things. First of all, Bowley's coefficient of skewness, also known as quartile coefficient of skewness. This is specifically from exam's point of view because there are chances that in question, you're not asked to find Bowley's coefficient of skewness, but you are asked to compute quartile coefficient of skewness. Right? Next, range. Range of Bowley's coefficient of skewness is always plus minus 1. That is, Bowley's coefficient of skewness is always less than or equal to 1 or greater than or equal to minus 1. Right? And any day we know that if Bowley's coefficient of skewness is greater than 0, positively skewed, and if Bowley's coefficient of skewness is less than 0, this is negatively skewed. Right? One important point that we need to know, that when is this actually required? This we use when we have open-end series, because we can easily calculate quartiles or median when we have open-end series data. That is, open-end series, we mean that if our data is like less than 10, and we get the frequency. So we don't know what is the lower limit. So in these cases, we need it. Or more than 10, we don't know the upper limit. So in these kinds of cases, we require this. And one more important point, that we can never compare Karl Pearson's coefficient of skewness with Bowley's coefficient of skewness. Because there's a possibility that both of them give us totally opposite sign. Although that is a very rare case, but there is such possibility. So we can never compare these two. These two are separate measures of coefficient of skewness. These are just some measures that statisticians have discovered. So it's all upon the discretion of the statistician or the person who was solving this question that which is a better measure to use. Now let's discuss an example. Calculate Bowley's coefficient of skewness for distribution having Q1 is equal to 30, Q2 is equal to 38, and Q3 is equal to 70. Now we know our Bowley's coefficient of skewness is simply Q3 plus Q1 minus 2Q2 upon Q3 minus Q1. So fetching in the values, 70 plus 30 minus 2 into 38. This upon 70 minus 30. We can say this is 100 minus 76 upon 40, which is 24 upon 40. Right? So this we know simply it is 0.6. So we can simply say that for this, Bowley's coefficient of skewness is greater than 0 and less than 1. So basically, since it is greater than 0, it is a positively skewed data or distribution. So this is how we compute Bowley's coefficient of skewness. I hope you like this video. Do subscribe this channel for more videos. Thank you.